you are my friend, but you are made of bone. And you have got no flesh and blood running through you to help protect the bone. Skeleton, we have been friends for years, and you have seen me through some trials and tribulations and some tears. But everybody thinks I'm weird, and I should have known that it wouldn't be long until you've got me standing in an awkward position with unwanted attention and a need for explanation. And it's not that I'm letting go of you, but I don't know what to do. Skeleton, we are so close, but you have got no body, so why do you insist on wearing clothes?
As the credits roll, allow me to invite up, first of all, our moderator tonight, Simi Linton. Simi, thank you so much for being here. Please welcome producer, director, editor, Daisy Wright. There you go. And of course, two people, I'll get you guys up together, who need no introduction, Gregg, Mozgala, and Tamar Rogoff. Before we get started, I'm also going to take a moment to thank our audio describers who created the audio description for this film, making it more accessible than ever. And we love your feedback and your comments on every film, so please fill out a feedback form as you leave. And looks like this, you could leave it with us at the door. Simi, over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for this work, and I just loved watching this. Gregg, I've known you for years, and we've never had the conversations that I just engaged in with you, and it was a treat. It was a treat to be part of this. A couple of things. One is, you know, of course, I was struck, Gregg, by how much trust you put in Tamar, and that was extraordinary, and you kind of gave yourself over to her in a way that is, it's hard for any of us to really relinquish that, and you must have trusted him enormously too, to put that kind of energy and that kind of focus in your work with him, and that you knew you were onto something. But the trust in yourself, because this is totally uncharted territory for anybody, and certainly for you, and you just seem to say, yeah, do this, do that, do this, do that. Were you making it up as you went along?
Yes. Well, I trust the body. I mean, I really am a worshiper of the body, and it's like I trust it more than me or Gregg. It's that the body's going to turn up what we need it to turn up. So if everything calms down and it's not, you know, if I can get in a quiet space and Gregg and I can talk and remove some of the boundaries that we usually have in a doctor's office or even in our dance rehearsal, you know, it's just that the answer just comes up, you know, just I didn't have any ideas about what, you know, I loved Gregg's body just the way it was when I saw it at first, and it just wouldn't have lasted on the stage for more than 3 minutes unless it was a piece about the fear of falling or just about falling, because that's what we did a lot. So, you know, it was just like, I just treated him like any other dancer. Like, you know, dancers have to have alignment. Mm-hmm. You can't support someone else's body if your pelvis and your hip, first of all, if everything isn't awake in your body. And so I really went from my dance training. So, but it was pretty mysterious.
But you'd been on stage many times before this.
As an actor, which is something different than dancing. There's a vulnerability and exposure. I mean, well, You all saw my body, right? I think, and I think it was not in the intense, the rigor and the incredible physical, like the physical intensity of dance does not exist. It exists in some levels of theater, mm-hmm. I would imagine, but nothing compares to dance in that way.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So I think it was, we had the space and time, we had the luxury of space and time to do this work. The dance was incredibly rigorous. And the act of partnering was one of the most difficult things I've ever done in my entire mm-hmm. life. It mm-hmm. that like all this work in the training to become a dancer confronted every last issue that I had with my cerebral palsy, physically, psychologically, emotionally. Mm-hmm. So I mean, you have to be close to somebody. You have to learn how to share weight. You have to, you know, be in tune with your body and their body at the same time. The proximity issues, balance. Mm-hmm. All that stuff. It was just we were attacking that all those issues through the practice and through the rehearsal.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why it was successful, because mm-hmm. we had the art piece around it. Mm-hmm. It had that structure. And again, we had the time mm-hmm. And the space. We were very fortunate to have that to do that. Mm-hmm. And that was the difference. Like, Tamar gave me agency over my own body.
Mm.
She gave me options and agency and said, you're going to do this to your sternum. You're going to do this with your rib cage. Uh-huh. You're going to do this with your cheekbones, the hair in your nostrils, you know? So I had to learn all that. It was uh-huh. all learned behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And that took time. We had absolutely no vocabulary
mm-hmm.
before we started. I didn't know how to talk about my body.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually our vocabulary became
mm-hmm.
the parts of the body itself. Mm-hmm. And we built out from there.
I have a couple of other things that I'm curious about, and then you folks can ask each other things, and then we will turn it over to the audience. Your initial title, which we don't learn until much of the way into the film, was Diagnosis of a Faun. And I remember when I first saw that, and I was quite, and I knew about the project, but I was quite put off by it. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what your thinking was, and at what point that went from Diagnosis of a Faun to Enter the Faun, and wondered, Daisy, if that was...
Why were you put off by Diagnosis?
Oh.
Come on.
No, I'm not hesitating, I'm thinking.
It wasn't close. I mean, mm-hmm. it was not... It was meant to say that we should not be ruled by our diagnosis. We should not be labeled. We should not. But I think it's a little bit from the ballet Afternoon of a Faun, mm-hmm. you know, so it's kind of that rhythm, Afternoon of a Faun, Diagnosis of a Faun.
Mm-hmm.
But go ahead.
Well, I was concerned that it medicalized your condition,
yeah.
you know, that the term diagnosis, which we read as what's the matter, would rule the piece.
Yeah, but
and as we see the piece, you know, I mean, I unfortunately missed it. I was out of town for your run. But the, you know, the dancing itself and the work itself doesn't speak to that, but I wondered, you know, where, what,
well, my own experience,
whether there was irony or what was going on there.
Sure, in my own experience, that medicalization of our community is part of our history.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's necessarily something we need to shy away from.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I've been doing this for a little while. There are those people who see disability. There's a manipulation there. You know, I think I've got a pretty good nose for that.
Mm-hmm.
And if Tamar, if I got one whiff of that from Tamar, I wouldn't have engaged in the project.
Uh-huh.
We met as artists. Mm-hmm. You know, the first thing she said was she saw me in a play, and
uh-huh.
you know,
mm-hmm.
said she liked my style.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I mean that's how we met.
Uh-huh.
You know,
uh-huh.
she didn't ask me any like mm-hmm. in our initial meetings.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't ask me anything about cerebral palsy. She didn't ask me anything about my disability.
Mm-hmm.
We both entered it as collaborators.
Mm-hmm.
And we discovered, again, we didn't know how to talk about any of this. And I think we developed this throughout the course of all this work. So I think that's, I don't think that ever really entered it.
Mm-hmm.
I know that word can be loaded. for our community, but it wasn't part of the process.
Yeah, it was. It sounds like what you're saying is that it was a comment on it.
Yeah, I think that's right.
But it wasn't just that. But in the performance, the Faun wanders into the medical community. Mm-hmm. The back of the stage is mm-hmm. the forest, and the front was the operating room and the medical uh-huh. community. And he wanders in search of his nymph, who is the actual one who has the physical. She breaks something, her Achilles heel, she falls. And, you know, so he wanders in and he becomes the subject. So it's part of the story.
Part of that narrative,
yes.
which I unfortunately didn't know. So, Daisy, when did you come into the project?
When did I come into the project? So well, Tamar and Gregg were obviously already working together. Mm-hmm. And I guess probably when they were rehearsing, and Tamar was shooting. She started shooting sort of right away when stuff started happening in the studio, mm-hmm. like all the sort of personal diary footage, we call it, mm-hmm. When she saw changes happening mm-hmm. in Gregg's body. Mm-hmm. And then Tamar and I have known each other a long time. We did another film together about 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. So anyway, we met and just started talking about the idea of, you know, could this be a film? What could it be? Mm-hmm. So they continued shooting, and but of course there was a lot going on because there was, you know, the making of the production, and then the mm-hmm. production went on tour. Mm-hmm. So little by little, I mean, I'm sure everybody could tell there were lots of different camera people that were involved, different camera styles, mm-hmm. But it was sort of shooting little by little as we could, while they were in rehearsals, and then while the performance toured, and then shooting continued once the performance was completely finished. Mm. We were still shooting, mm-hmm. And then we started editing, I guess, in 2010 or 2011, mm-hmm. And that went on for a long time. Yeah. A very long time, and in increments, you know. Mm-hmm. Tamar did a whole other choreographic piece. I did other jobs. You know, it came in piecemeal. So, but yeah,
great.
Yeah.
Did you want to add something, Gregg?
Oh, I just think Daisy Wright did an amazing job making this movie.
Agreed.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, let us speak to our audience here. Many questions. I saw your hand. Well, go ahead, Isaac. You're there.
Hi. I had the honor of being at your debut performance, which was amazing. And I was just wondering if you guys are going to do another piece together, or have.
We haven't really talked about it. Again, Tamar, I think, is on to her next piece. Again, she's done another piece in between this. We're doing a lot of outreach associated with the film. We're talking about that. So we have this group that we meet once a month. We call ourselves the Cerebral Posse. Peter right here is a part of it. Michelle, Colleen, some people in this room are involved. Some people were there last Wednesday. We're trying to just take this work even further, bring it out to more people, explain it, disseminate it further, and put it to use. And in that, you know, dance is a big part of that. So we have done in the past some collaborations with. We did a collaboration with Hunter College and their dance program there. So there's, I think, everywhere we go and screen the film, we always want the. We try to have the disability community, the dance community, and the medical community present, mm-hmm. and bring those three disparate communities together. Mm-hmm. But I think there's, I think what really made the work successful was the art form, was dance. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, bringing that into it. It's more interesting, it's physical. Again, there's a rigor associated with it, a focus, a discipline, and I think that's what helped lead to any changes that occur. But it's giving people, again, I don't think the concepts are that difficult. Mm-hmm. It's just giving people, we talk about access and awareness all the time, right? But we very rarely turn that in on into our own body. And I think that was the huge difference for me. And that's so we're just trying to talk very simply and plainly, and then put it into action.
Hey, for Gregg. Hi.
Hi,
Gabe Rhodes, everybody here. Hi. How important do you think it is, in order to collaborate, to be on equal footing with the other person? No pun intended about the footing part.
In what sense? I mean, you always want to find a collaborator that you can communicate well with and work well with and have a shorthand with, but I think, you know, that takes time to develop. And sometimes, you know, Tamar, Simi talked about this trust that we had. That didn't happen overnight. You know, this is 3 years condensed into 68 minutes. You know, so, I mean, it's, you know, Tamar's twice my age. You know, it wasn't like, you know, it wasn't like, yeah, I'll lay down with you. And, you know, it's like, I've met your grandkids. You know, so, I mean, that didn't, you know, that took some time. You know, but, you know, and to your earlier point, Simi, like, once I knew that she knew what she was talking about, she had this incredible love and respect for the body, just something I didn't have, right? That was something, again, a learned behavior that she passed on to me. I was like, okay, this woman's for real, right? I mean, I can learn something from her. And we were teaching each other. Like, Tamar's often said, I taught her what she knows. You know, so this is a unique... This is a neat collaboration. You always hope for that in a collaborator, you know? But this was, sometimes you just get lucky.
Well, the first part was a collaboration in the studio with the body work, but as soon as we got to the theater and to the other actors and dancers, then we had different roles. Then I was the choreographer and he was the dancer. So we really had to shift. And I collaborate with my performers, but in a different way than that searching out of, you know, how Gregg was going to find balance. It was really two different chapters.
Okay.
Hey, y'all. Fabulous work across the board. You know, deep respect. So this project started, the body work started, what, how long ago exactly?
8 years ago.
8 years ago. Jeez. So it is never ending. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, never play an immortal character.
That's the lesson.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, you talked about how, you know, inclusion and access is something that, the buzzwords that get thrown around a lot, but we don't often apply that to our own bodies that we walk around in all the time. And I think another word that gets thrown around a lot is embodiment. Right, and this is the personification of embodiment. Right, you've got to be in the body to do dance work, and I'm curious to know as the project or even projects have evolved from body work to dance to now the film, how that's evolved for each of you, and maybe how you were surprised by that process. You know, what you expected maybe initially, and then at the end of it, how it gobsmacked you. Now in hindsight, with the 8 years to look back.
Well, you know, I'm still figuring out what it was we did.
Yeah.
And every time I see the film, I figure out a little bit more. I mean, it's really like we picked up the camera, we weren't planning to make a documentary. It's that we thought no one would believe us. So I said, oh, we better get the camera. But it, you know, this, it just... Being in the moment and working like that, and then having the time to look back on it during these screenings, I realize, you know, it's the choices, what the choices were, and if we were to work now, because I'm always moving along with what I do, we would be doing something completely different. So, I mean, it is a very interesting thing, and Daisy and I just spent... Oh, a million hours, you know, in the edit room, just looking at all the material we didn't use, you know, and then it was so interesting to try to make a cohesive film that hit, you know, all of the points, and dancers and doctors and people in the disability community would all be able to, you know, mm-hmm. to see it. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, I just still, you know, I'm still looking around. I'm going to spend the next year thinking about Matthew because he came to the workshop today, and I said, everybody put your hand on your sacrum, and he said, I don't have a sacrum. Mm-hmm. And I found, and I was all like, oh, Matthew, are we going to be together for the next 8 years? It was like, how am I going to solve the problem of Maria? You know, it's like, doesn't have us. And I mean, it's so, and immediately I think, what a hero you are. How do you do this? So it's, I mean, and another thing, Lawrence, is that, you know, my eye was always pretty sharp about body and my sense of body empathy, but nothing like after this process. Mm-hmm. So now I'm like, it's almost a curse because I see, because I learned to look at Gregg like that because it really mattered, I'm looking at everybody like that, including myself. Well, mm-hmm. less myself, like everybody, but yeah, there's just, you need all these years mm-hmm. for such a thing.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay, we have a question there, then in the front, and then we'll get to you, then we'll get to you. Okay, go ahead.
Whoa. I was in Salem last weekend, and I missed your film. I could only see so many, and I didn't know exactly what would be what, so I heard great things about it, and that's why I'm here tonight. And I have to say, there was a lot of talk in Salem, and it was your film had a lot of conversation, excited a lot of people. And there was talk about the camera work is, you know, is rough, and what I found was that the camera work was very gritty, like iPhone gritty, and not well lit, and all of that, and immediately that worked so well because there's a real grit to the people in it, and the work they're doing is very gritty, and that worked so well. It would not, I think, have worked well if it was more polished in its production value and in how it looked. But the storytelling, Tamar and Daisy, is elegant and precise and really beautiful.
Thank you.
My hat is off to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And we loved Salem.
And Jaron, and then Julie, and then you, and then you.
Yeah, congratulations on this film as well. Just want to say a big shout out to Gregg, you sexy beast. but I'm also really interested in this.
You don't have to respond to that.
You don't respond to that. So humble, so humble.
Silence is sexy.
I'm really interested in the distinct mindsets of process and production, and in terms of this very intimate process that you and Tamar and you and Gregg kind of executed, but then the mindset that had to change to actually produce a work on stage, and could you talk a little bit about how you had to shift this exploratory phase into a maybe a plastic, almost a plastic, almost like a fix, like you had to leave this malleable mindset to get to a fixed, replicated, you know, movement style, and also something that could be no other term, sellable, you know, like you couldn't explore on stage as liberally as you did in the process. Could you talk about how you changed your mindset to produce at La Mama and elsewhere?
I think one funneled into the other. I mean, the work didn't end, you know, even when we went into rehearsal. I mean, we did have to shift, right? I mean, I understand performance. I understand, you know, what that means. This was totally different and much more terrifying in the sense of I've never done this before. But, you know, I would only say, like, we were cocooned initially, just the two of us, when the other dancers came in. And Emily and Lucy, the two dancers in the piece, like, they made me look really good. Like, they are fantastic, fantastic dancers. So what they were able to do, and just their openness and their generosity towards this process was incredible. But, that being said, I mean, you just heard me, like, make one recording, like, of being frustrated and upset through that process. I mean, it was the hardest thing I have ever done. incredibly worthwhile, but I was an emotional basket case. Because I had to confront all these issues with myself, and I was learning a totally new art form in a year. You know, so that was really, really difficult. So I would say when we got into the theater and tech and all that stuff, that was known for me. You know, I know what this is. Okay, let's do it. The art form was different, and the piece was different, but I knew what that was at least.
And you've experienced a very similar trajectory in terms of transformation and becoming a dancer in a short amount of time.
Yes.
as well.
So I guess what my real question is, like, how do you feel that you had to orchestrate your body in a replicated way that you couldn't rely on the fact your body is able to, I don't know, like, you couldn't rely on the fact that you that your body changes. You had to read the script every night.
Oh, well, that was the structure. That was amazing. I mean, that actually, goodbye, Margot. You were great.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Margot,
from the end of the movie.
Think about it, Margot. Yeah. Yeah.
Yay.
Similar process to what he went through, the learning my body, not so much for a dance, but just learning how to ask my body what I wanted to do. And now I'm in a place where I feel I can pretty much ask my body to do anything I wanted to do, and that has really set me free as an adult for what I'm going to do with my life. So I'm forever grateful to Gregg for that. But
okay.
I'm so glad to be here and that everybody loved this film. Keep dancing, people.
Thanks, Margo. Yeah.
Great.
You know, it's actually easier for, it's probably, Jeron, it's easier for us to dance than it is to walk. Because whatever we've determined is walking, right, is what our, it's what we did to copy non-disabled people, you know, our parents or family around us, right? With a damaged brain, right? So within the limits of what our body allowed us to do, right? When it was still forming, right? And so, but dance is outside of the habitual pattern of whatever walking is, right? So Tamar, that script was actually incredibly helpful, right? As an actor, if you do Shakespeare, right, the dum de dum de dum de dum de dum, right, he gives you the meter and the rhythm. He tells you what the character's emotional life is based on the way he writes the lines, right? So if I stayed in that script, I was so supremely focused, right? So I was always protected through this process. And I also had, the other dancers with me and everything else. So it took me... I couldn't think about that, you know, in performance. But I was incredibly taken care of because of Tamar's particular choreographic language and the fact that I think inhabiting a character also was the key to the success of this process too. Because, you know, it's not me. It's something, I'm accessing something else in my brain. I'm accessing something else in my imagination. You know, it's like an avatar of myself. Right, and that was just something. I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
We have time for two last questions. We're going to take one over here.
Okay. Julie actually had her hand up, and then we'll take Julie. Okay. Great. Go ahead.
Hello. Up here. Congratulations. I thought it was absolutely extraordinary. Gregg, I just wanted to ask you, through this process, how much do you feel it changed you as an actor? afterwards, because we have, as an actors, we have an emotional toolbox that we access, right? And as we go through life and we experience things, that toolkit becomes added to, and we use things and we put them back, and sometimes the tools don't work anymore, and so we throw them away. So I just wondered, for you in your career as an actor, what tools are in there that will never leave that box ever again?
You know, I'm just that, thank you for asking that question. I'm just now starting to sort of figure this out. The fact that I can actually admit that I'm disabled on stage is a huge step. Because previously, it's just you have to, as a self-preservation tactic, right? Try and convince the world that you're not disabled as you move through, you know, your day, which is completely self-delusional, right? But you do it. I don't know. I mean, I do it. I don't know if that's true for anyone else. But it's just, you know, so when I went on stage, it was like, look at me, nothing funny going on here. So I would be, you know, performing a soliloquy or something, right? And my leg would be shaking, and I wouldn't acknowledge it. I would get stuck, like my body wouldn't let me move. And so I'd do it in this weird, you know, I'd have to muscle through everything. So it's just, I think what this process is giving, and I'm, by not acknowledging it, I'm denying a huge aspect of my humanity, right? So my acting is going to be less full. It's going to be false. Because with a disability, that's how I, through this body, with all its idiosyncrasies, this is how I access my emotions and everything else. So it's a real tricky thing to actually admit. You know, it's hard. And I've heard this expressed by other people, like to identify as disabled, to acknowledge it, is a really difficult thing. I'm still working on it. But I think as an actor, to say to myself, okay, this funny thing is happening, I have to just deal with it right now. Because every character I ever play is going to be disabled, you know? Every character is going to have cerebral palsy. I can't change that. And in a rehearsal process, to be like, this is what I need, and this is what's going on with my body. And because of the vocabulary we developed, I now have vocabulary to take to a director or other castmates or producers or whomever. You know, and I think that's this is new territory for me. I have to practice it, but that's what I'm working on.
Okay.
I have so much I'd like to say, but I'll narrow it down, obviously, to one question, and that is, what would your cerebral palsy posse have to offer for somebody who has cerebral palsy, like me, for example, and who uses a wheelchair and is not dealing with the kind of like internalized ableism stuff, like that wouldn't necessarily want to be closer to a quote unquote normal body or able-bodied body, but would want to be less in less pain or,
sure,
you know, so for somebody in, very simply, for somebody in a wheelchair, what would your practice have to offer?
Sure.
Because cerebral palsy is very different, obviously.
Yeah, there's a huge spectrum, yeah. Right. And I would say I didn't want to be closer to a normal body. What this process did was give me my own body, right? I still have CP, it's not going to go away, you know? And I think, I understand what you're saying, I just wanted to clarify. So we have a woman in, Colleen is in our posse, right? This young woman, I don't know, I'll call her a young woman. Alejandro Espina is in our posse. You know, she's brought up the same issue. She's also in a chair, is not ambulatory. You know, I'm so glad she's there because, I mean, it forces us to think differently and problem solve in that way, get creative. And, I mean, everyone has sits bones. Everyone has a sternum. You know, you are in relationship to your chair, right? No, I'm sorry. I said sternum, right? I mean, you never know, right? You learn so much at ReelAbilities. But, you know, she, you know, we did this whole... Sorry, I'll try to be concise as possible. Oh, we gave everybody the investigation of, like, notice how you get out of bed in the morning, right? And either body script yourself a new way out of that bed or script the way you do it every day. And so Alejandra has this very specific process. She needs to get in a bed a certain way, like the way her apartment is configured, like the angle needs to be right in her chair. All we did was get her from sitting to, like, two hands on the bed. But we scripted that those movements within an inch of her, inch of their life, right? And she suddenly became more conscious and more aware of that process and how she could call on her body to do that and call on her breath to do that. And I think we're just, I mean, it's all about just your own awareness in your body, regardless of the severity or how CP affects you. So we are, yeah, so I guess, I don't know, it's, we'll work with what you got. Come as you are, you know, all bodies welcome.
This is the final roundup. I've been given the, can you,
sorry.
And thank you to our interpreter, Laura Molden, as well. As I've said many, many, many times, it's all about dance. Thank you very much for this work, for this film, and for your ongoing work, because it's very exciting. I love that cerebral posse. That's terrific.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you
so much. Thank you.
Thank you.